You'll take your Bibles and turn to Galatians. Galatians chapter 5. See if I can find it in my Bible. Usually I have it marked before I come up here, but I forgot to mark it this week. Here we go. Galatians chapter 5, verses 7 and 8 is where we're going to be today. I don't know how many of you may remember, but Tuesday we're it's an anniversary of an event that occurred a couple of years ago here in the city of Sandusky. How many of you know what I'm talking about? No? Tuesday. Let's see if this will refresh your memory. Not a celebration, but commemoration or whatever, just remember. But about 4:20 in the afternoon on October 8th, 2022, an eastbound Norfolk Southern train derailed. It was scattered about 20 rail cars and tanker cars into the surrounding properties by the railroad tracks there, including a few that landed on the road and sidewalk at the Columbus Avenue underpass. Now you remember. I remember it because John and Jason and I were at the Ohio State-Michigan State game in Michigan, and our phones started blowing up with all this talk about a train derailment. In addition to the mangled mess of metal, the contents of the tankers, which happened to be paraffin wax, spilled into the city sewer system, and it hardened and stopped up the sewer system or portions of it, stopping the flow of more than just traffic. It took 7 months of cleanup, 7 months before the underpass was fully open for traffic. Now, back in the apostles' day, they didn't have to deal with stuff like that, trains and automobiles and all kinds of things like that. But in our text today, Paul actually does describe what you might call a derailment that occurred in the Galatian church. So let's read these verses together. Galatians chapter 5, verses 7 and 8. Paul says, "You were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth?" In verse 8, "This persuasion is not from him who calls you." If you were to read that in the NIV and some other translations, it would say, "You were running a good race. Who cut in on you to keep you from obeying the truth?" That kind of persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. The train derailment that occurred 2 years ago was caused by defective equipment. But there's all kinds of reasons that a train might derail. Sometimes it may be human error or excessive speed, defective tracks, collisions with cars or debris that are on the tracks, or maybe even other trains. There's a lot of reasons that a train might derail, and likewise, there are a lot of reasons that we as Christians might experience a derailment of our own in our spiritual journey. And as we dig into our text today, we're going to consider three forces that derail us as Christians. Let's pray together. Father, now as we come to your word, Lord, we're all here for you, as we've already sung, as we've said earlier, and we need to hear from you. We are here to hear from you, Lord. Your word guides us. Your word contains truth that is so important and relevant for each and every one of our lives. And so, Father, we pray and ask that you would speak to each and every one of us right where we are today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, We're going to just dive right in. There are three derailing forces. There are more. Okay, but we're going to talk in the text. We're going to pull three derailing forces. And to give you a little bit of background of where we're going, I'm going to reference Acts, starting in Acts chapter 13. If you were to go and read in Acts chapter 13 and the following chapters, you would read about the first missionary journey. Paul and Barnabas were commissioned by the church in Antioch to take the gospel to the world, to the Gentiles. And so they set out and did just that. And as they were going to all of these different places that they went to, mostly in Asia Minor, they were followed. There was a trail of this other group following along behind them. And I guess they were men from Jerusalem. They were Jews from Jerusalem, and they were religious Jews from Jerusalem. And I guess they felt like they needed to go along behind Paul and Barnabas and kind of correct some of the things that Paul and Barnabas were teaching. See, Paul and Barnabas were taking the gospel, good news about freedom, that we can be forgiven of our sins. And that apart from the law. No matter how good you followed the law, it didn't forgive you of your sins. It didn't satisfy the requirement of God, because Jesus is the only one who can do that. And so that is the gospel that Paul and Barnabas were preaching as they went through Asia Minor. One of the locations they went to was Galatia. But this group of men from Jerusalem decided that, well, we might need to go behind them and correct a few things. Because our religion says that we follow the law of Moses. And a part of the law of Moses says that you must be circumcised to be a part of the kingdom of God. And so they would go everywhere Paul and Barnabas went, and they began to teach these things. And here we got these brand new Christians in Galatia and all these other places who have been set free from their sins, and they've started out in a new way of life, started out on their journey, and here comes these people, and it just kind of derails them with this requirement. Remember, these people aren't Jews. They're Gentiles. They're not followers of the Jewish traditions and religions and rituals. And so along come these Jewish religious people to put these new layer of rules and regulations and do's and don'ts on top of them. And they're telling them you have to do these things in order to be a part of God's family. And so they get derailed. You know, when you look up the word derail in the dictionary, you're going to find words like oppose, obstruct, stop in the definition. When we think of the devil's job description, derail very well might be one of the words included, because that's exactly what he wants to do to every human being. That's exactly what he wants to do to you and to me. He wants to keep us from being with Jesus, much less becoming like Jesus and doing as Jesus did. But Jesus describes the devil's job description in even stronger terms in John chapter 10, verse 10. You all are familiar with this verse. When Jesus said, "The thief comes only to kill, steal, and destroy." My goodness, what a purpose statement that is. You better believe that the devil's good at doing his job, too. One of the reasons that he is so good at his job is because we already have three forces in our life working against us, three derailing forces working against us. These are separate from the devil. The devil just comes alongside these three forces, and he starts tinkering and manipulating in order to derail us, to cut us off from getting closer to Jesus. So what are these three forces? Well, the first one is our sin nature. The first derailing force is our sin nature. We're all born with a sin nature, natural tendency to reject God and to do our own thing. Do you realize that sin begins with us? It doesn't start with the devil. It doesn't start anywhere else. It begins with us. We have this sin nature that we have a tendency to be drawn and involved in sin. Now that might prompt a question. You might say, wait a minute. If we're born like this with a sin nature, then how is sin our fault? How is that fair? Even though we're born with a sin nature, we still have to make the choice to follow through on sin. We don't have to be controlled by our sin nature. Think about this just a moment. Some of us may be just naturally angry. Might want to lash out, knock people upside the head every once in a while. But somehow we're able to resist that urge, right? We're able to resist that natural tendency. Some of us may have other natural tendencies towards, maybe it's alcohol addiction or drugs. Maybe it's sexual promiscuity. There's any number of things that we may have these natural tendencies to engage in, and yet somehow we restrain ourselves to keep ourselves, or hopefully we restrain ourselves to keep ourselves doing that. Whether we do or not, we can, is the point. People reject these natural tendencies all the time. And we can do the same thing with our sin nature. It's true for every sinful choice we make. It is a choice. In the book of James, he makes this very clear in chapter 1, verse 14. He says, "But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by what? By his own selfish desire. Then desire, when it is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death." So yes, we are born into this sinful nature. We have this tendency to sin. But we make the choice to engage in sinful activity. And when we do, when we're tempted and we give in to it, we sin, then we brought death into our lives. That's exactly what happened in the garden with Adam and Eve. That's where death originated. And when it comes down to it, this derailing force of the sinful nature, we are our own worst enemy because we constantly give in to that sinful nature. How you feeling about yourself so far? That's just the first influencer or the first force in our life. It's trying to keep us away from Jesus. That's just the first one. I would think that would be enough. Why does there have to be more? But there are. There are more. The second one is the world. This world. We live in a world that is full of people who are just like we are. And because the majority of humanity either ignorantly or willingly gives in to the sinful nature, our world and its trends, its fads, and cultures, they all have a significant influence in our lives. They are a force in our lives. We've talked a lot about how we have been formed by the world around us since the day we were born, since even before we were born. Not only do we have to guard ourselves from ourselves, but we have to guard ourselves from the world around us. 1 John chapter 2, verse 16 tells us why we should avoid the influence of the world. John says, "For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and the pride of life is not from the Father, but it's from the world." And then verse 17, he says, "And the world is passing away along with its desires." The world is passing away. Its fate is sealed. Its doom is sure. Allowing the world to have influence or to be a force in our lives will only subject us to share in its fate. But yet there's still one more force, one more derailing force in our life. And this one might be a little bit surprising. Religion. Religion can be a derailing force in our lives. As we said earlier, the gospel sets us free. But oftentimes, religion tries to put shackles and chains back on us. It tries to enslave us to a set of rules and rituals that only hinder us from becoming like Jesus. While many great things have been done in the name of religion, it has also done just as much to keep people away from Jesus. Religion is the very force that Paul is referencing in the text that we read earlier today that derailed the Galatian Christians. Boy, I tell you what, it almost seems like there is no way we could possibly win this battle. We are bound to be derailed at some point in time. So I guess the question is, when we get derailed, what do we do about it? How can we get back on track? And that brings us back to three driving goals that we're learning about in practicing the way. You're going to hear these things over and over again. I hope you never get tired of them, because we need to hear these things over and over again. How can we get on the right track and stay on the right track? Well, we have to flip the script. I mean, we have to learn and practice the countercultural and sometimes counterintuitive way of Jesus. We must learn to think and behave in a way that goes against our sinful nature. It goes against the world, and yes, even sometimes may go against religion. Spiritual development doesn't happen by accident. It is happening to us whether we realize it or not. And if we're truly going to be followers of Christ, then we must be intentional about rearranging the values and the priorities in our lives to accurately reflect that we are followers of Christ. And there are the three driving goals that will help us accomplish this. Number one is be with Jesus. That's a matter of proximity, spiritually speaking. You know, when you think of being with someone, you might talk to them on the phone, or maybe you go over to the house and sit for a while and visit. Maybe you go out to eat. You do things together. You spend time together. We put away the practices of the sinful nature of the world and even the religious practices that don't bring you closer to Jesus, and we replace those with practices that help us to engage more with Jesus. Prayer, Bible intake, solitude, meditation, all of these things that focus our attention and help us to strengthen and enhance our relationship with Jesus. Listen, we've all heard these things all our lives if we've been in church, and it sounds great, but it's worth nothing if we don't implement it and if we don't practice it every day in our lives. The second driving force or driving goal there is to become like Jesus in his personality. We want people to be able to look at us and say, wow, you look a lot like Jesus. You remind me of Jesus. As you become like him, pay attention to the changes in your thought patterns and your attitude and your interactions with others. As you become like Jesus, you'll know you'll notice more and more of the fruits of the Spirit, which are just a few verses down in Galatians, by the way, and we sang about them earlier too. You'll notice that the more of the fruits of the Spirit begin to manifest in your life, you'll find that you're becoming more loving and joyful, peaceful and patient, kind and good, faithful, gentle, and self-controlled. I just watched a little video of a little girl. She must have been 4 years old, maybe. And her mother was behind the camera, and the camera was on the young little girl. And the mother said, "Oh, are you pretty?" And the little girl said, "Yes." "Are you happy?" "Yes." And asked her a few other things. And then she said, "Are you kind?" And the little girl froze. And then she said, "Not so much." You know, and I think it's like we want to see those fruits of the Spirit manifesting in our lives so that we can confidently say, "Yes, I am kind." But a lot of us might step back from some of that and say, "Not so much. Not so much." We want to become like Jesus, not just so that other people can see it, but so that we can see it. A lot of times other people will see things in us and we don't even see it in ourselves. And a lot of times it's not really good. The blind spot's there. It'd be so much better to have a blind spot that I'm actually kind, I'm actually good, I'm actually loving. And I don't recognize it. Not out of some sense of false humility, but because I truly am seeking to follow Jesus. I truly am becoming more and more like him. And for his glory, it's being noticed by others. And then the third driving goal is to do as Jesus did. That relates to our behavior and our activity to be a source of comfort and companionship to those who are lonely and isolated. A little more of Jesus, a little less like me. You know? We can reach out with hope to and love to those who are lost. We can encourage the downtrodden. We can visit and pray for the sick. We can feed the hungry. We can take the light into the dark places. We can lovingly communicate truth and actively engage in service to others. These are the things that Jesus did. And they're the things that his followers do. See, practicing the way is not just a book. And it's not just a Bible study group. But it is a way of life. It's a way of living that is so different than most of us have ever imagined. I might even suggest all of us have ever imagined. Much less experienced. But it is the way that Jesus calls his followers to live. We must be willing to make the changes in our lives that will put us and keep us on the right track. The Galatians, they weren't the only people who got derailed. They weren't the only people in the Bible that got derailed. So Paul also wrote to the Corinthian church about some issues that they had that had derailed them as well. I guess when it comes down to it, they were making somewhat of a mockery of the Lord's Supper. They had become very cliquish within the church. And certain groups of people would gather together and they would begin the meal together and they'd pretty much eat everything up and drink everything up, not waiting on anybody else who might be coming. They were excluding some. They were impatient with others. They were selfish. Paul even goes so far as to say there are some who are going hungry while others of you are just getting drunk. And he says, "Don't you have homes? You can do this stuff at home. Why come and disrespect God's house like this?" You know, when we think about practicing the way, or maybe we might be derailed. The things that have derailed us have sidetracked us, and we're kind of over here when we should be over here. Now is the time for us to really do some business with God about that. Now is the time for us to acknowledge those things before the Lord, to confess those things to Him, and to get those things right. If we're not willing to do that, we have no business doing this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 through 26, Paul says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you." He's telling them, hey, you know how this is supposed to work. I've already told you this. That the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Why are we doing this? And then in verse 25, he goes on, he says, "In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and he says, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" I got to admit, there have been times that I have participated in the Lord's Supper and I've disrespected God. And I, if we're all honest, I'm sure we all have. As the music plays here in just a moment, we're going to observe the Lord's Supper together. And during this time, will you consider how maybe you've gotten derailed? Will you confess that to God? And would you commit to getting your life back on track by answering his call to practice his way? Let's pray together. Lord God, you are such an amazing God. Oftentimes we come to this table and we observe the Lord's Supper, and we're so thankful for the fact that you gave your body and you shed your blood so that we could be forgiven of our sins. But oftentimes, Lord, we are just willing to leave it all right there. We don't want to go any deeper or any farther. But Lord, we acknowledge today that you've also given us practices and habits and things that we can do to enhance our relationship with you, to help us to go deeper with you, so that we can not only be with you, but that we can be like you, and that we can do as you did. So, Father, during this time this morning, as we partake of these elements, we do commit our lives to you, Lord. I know it's hard. It's not something we're used to. It's something that we're going to have to practice. But Lord, help us to be willing to make those changes and to never give up and to always follow you. There was one time, as Peter said, "Who else do we have to turn to? Our hope is found only in you. You are our living hope." And so we do this as worship and as an act of commitment to you. And we love you in Jesus' name.
Desperate. spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken.
Practicing the way, living with Jesus is something that goes with us every single day, and he draws us closer and closer. I pray that you are encouraged by that and even challenged to take that next step, wherever you might be, in following God. Let's pray together as we close. Lord, we thank you for your demonstration of love on the cross. And Lord, your demonstration of power as you rose again from the grave. And Lord, we can have that same love and power in our lives, not only in us, but through us as we share it with those around us. And so, Father, I pray that you would just overtake us in such a way that the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, all of those things would be manifested in our lives, that we would see how much we're looking like Jesus, and that the world would see how much we're looking like Jesus, not for us to be able to brag or boast, but Lord, for your glory. And we ask that in doing all of that, you would draw people to yourselves. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. We'll look forward to seeing you next Sunday.